Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, let's start. And so today is the sixth lecture of the course, and this is pre-last lecture, let me say, right? So the last one will be next week. So today we are going to discuss some questions that are related with the 19th century. And I decided to give it the title like that, so the 19th century and the overcoming of classical rationality. So as far as you remember, last time we were talking about the development and, well, the emergence and development of so-called classical rationality, and it was very closely connected with the appearance of experiment and the idea of accurate and exact knowledge that we can gain from studying the outer world and the very nature as such, right? So, of course, that was a certain visiting card of the 18th century, and you remember that probably the most illustrious phenomenon in the 18th century was the great encyclopedia by Diderot and D'Alembert, right? So today we are going to speak about the development of the idea of science, and of course we will face with such a problem as overcoming of this project of classical rationality, and certainly we will focus on some questions that are not primarily of history of science or philosophy of science, but some historical questions. So, for example, besides the idea of the Industrial Revolution, we are going to discuss the phenomenon of Great French Revolution, which really helped and provoked the emergence and development of so-called middle class, as we know it today. So this is, I would say, the birth of our contemporaneity, right? Not also modernity, but the very crucial questions of the present time. Also, we can't help saying some words concerning the epoch of Romanticism and positivism. So these two the movements of the 19th century could be also helpful in respect of the illustration how the process of thought really developed. So on the one hand, we had very romantic and, well, we could even say ambitious agenda for the very beginning of the 19th century. On the other hand, we have the understanding of development of science as the objective knowledge, and thus we have the demand for actually the object knowledge about philosophy, and philosophy becomes the project of some objectivity, right? So the philosophy becomes the question and actually the challenge as the objective and strict knowledge, right? And finally, we can't ignore such important doctrines as the one of Darwin and the other of Nietzsche. So probably these two men were the most influential, not even in their own time, in the very middle and the second even part of the 19th century, but they were also very important for the further discussion, because you know that so-called STS, right, or evolutionary theory, right, actually got the development in terms of genetics and biology, right, and so forth in the very beginning of the 20th century. And Nietzsche, of course, is one of the most influential figures for the so-called philosophical 20th century. So we also would discuss these things. But first of all, we have to concentrate upon the phenomenon of Industrial Revolution, and we have to say some words about the definition. So what do we mean by Industrial Revolution? First of all, we mean that this phenomenon, well, this very historical event, is the transition to a new manufacturing process in the period from about 1760 to almost 1840. As far as you remember, on the very at the very first lecture, we discussed the possible answers to the question, when did science appear? And one of the answers, one of the possible answers, was the end of the 18th and the beginning of the 19th century in terms of the Industrial Revolution. Why this answer is possible? First of all, because the Industrial Revolution provoked many social factors that gave a completely different aspect of science as a certain human action, the very field of activity. So when we talk about how the processes and the means of industry developed and differed, and so they changed, we also mean that these were followed by a certain distinguishing, let me say, concerning the idea of what we can, how can we think about this process, right? And how can we understand what must a person do to work in the field of science? So industry and science, so practice and theory actually, becomes very closely connected in this period of time, and probably this is very understandable, right? This is very considerable, especially if we remember that in the project of Great French Encyclopedia, Diderot meant that we do not also need to we do not only need to study arts and sciences, but also crafts, right? And so once again, right, so practice and theory goes hand by hand, right? As far as we are considering the main factors of the Industrial Revolution, so how do people understand and how do the experts really understand this process? Was it objective, or that was just a kind of a certain phenomenon that we have to think about in respect of one type of society or maybe even one country? So there are different points of view. We really decided to take the most probably conventional one. So that is one of a famous Nobel Prize winner, Sir John Hicks. And he says that there are the following factors of the Industrial Revolution that took place not only in England, where the Industrial Revolution actually happened for the first, but also it concerns different countries such as France and Germany, and then the Netherlands and so forth, right? So we are, in this respect, we are speaking about the European phenomenon. So among these factors, we find the emergence of the institutes that protect private property and contract obligations. Before that time, so before the second part of the 18th century, we can find few examples of this kind of protection and this kind of independence of contract obligations and contracts as such, because that time was, well, the feudal system, let me say, all over the Europe was really in force. And only from the second part of the 18th century we can say that the idea of independence and actually the responsibility of the masters, the responsibility of those who run their businesses, so we could say businessmen, right, in our present terms, rises, so it increases. And of course, it was supported by the objective social factors, such as the Great American Revolution, right? I mean, the Independence War, and of course, the Declaration of Independence, which took part, which took place in 1776. And of course, Great French Revolution, when the king of France was first dismissed, right? On the other hand, this factor of the institute that protect private property and contract obligation had a consequence, such a consequence as the effective judicial system. So, of course, if we are responsible for our contracts and we are responsible in front of those whom we pay money or whom we hire or fire and so forth, we have to be protected with law. And that is why we can say that in the very In the second part of the 18th century, and really in the end of it, we find the great development and rise of the judicial system and law practices. The second factor is high level of trade development, and I think it's more or less clear, especially from that point of view, that this time we find the rise of the British Empire, and this is the time of colonies. So we have, we find a lot of colonies this time, such as India, for example, in Great Britain, and different islands, right? In France, we have we find colonies in Africa and so forth. So, of course, this kind of trade development was very ambitious, and it really connected the world in terms of the routes, in terms of the trade ways, and how really people connect with each other, right? Especially, we will find this kind of influence concerning this connection of different parts of the world in the second part of the 18th century, when people understood that the world is not so large as they used to think. The third factor is forming of the market of producing institutions, and of course it is closely connected with the previous one, right, with the trade development. And first of all, the land market. Of course, the feudal relationships that occurred in the Middle Ages were still in force, and the idea that, for example, there is the king's land, right, or the land of this or that nobleman, it's also in power, but still, we find those who can buy and sell lands in terms of their business work, right, in terms of their own interests on the market. That is why we can say that this position is also connected with the first one, so the effective judicial system as such, right? The fourth aspect is the widespread usage of hired labor, and it's more illustrious even that it becomes impossible to use the forced labor commonly. An interesting trait of the end of the 18th century is that this was the time when people started thinking about the differences of ages. You remember that on the factors and the manufacturers, actually, a lot of children used to work, right? And that was really the time, or the period of time, when people from the 12, when they become 12 years old and so forth, they work the same full time, right? Or probably even more, so the usual time was, as far as you remember, 12 hours, right? But not less than 10. And the very end of the 18th century really provoked this idea that we have childhood as a certain period of age, as a certain age, actually, and that we must protect children, we must protect the adults, we must protect their rights and their responsibilities. And certainly, we cannot make people work. We may offer them some business, but still, it becomes less and less possible to use the forced labor, because, as you can see, the third aspect says that the land trading, for example, became independent and free of feudal restrictions, and these feudal restrictions also meant the way people worked, the way people toiled, even, right? So the last two aspects, the development of financial markets and low level of loan interest, and the development of science, are also closely connected. For example, we may remember about famous Adam Smith and famous economists that started working that time. In France, for example, one of the encyclopedicists was famous economist Hugo. And here, we, in this period of time, we find people who really try to give the scientific point of view to what does it mean to work, or what does it mean to run business and how it must be protected, or what responsibilities must one take into consideration among himself or among, concerning himself or his own workers, right? So I would like to emphasize this idea. The Industrial Revolution was not also only historical, but I mean in terms of history of science or history of industry, but also very social phenomenon, which is closely connected with the understanding of human beings. So what place, which place takes the human being, and how can we understand that people are equal or different, what are their responsibilities, and how we must protect them, right? So we have to say some words about people who really created the Industrial Revolution. This will be a kind of just brief recommendation, brief introduction, right, into the history of this period of time. So you remember that in the 1698, the first steam pump occurred, well, it appeared, and the one who constructed it was a famous inventor, Captain Thomas Savery. He is also famous for getting one of the first patents. So he patented the early steam engine. And we have this interesting formula for what, right, was this patent. So a new invention for raising a water and occasioning motion to all sorts of mill work by the impelled force of fire, right? So here we can find also the construction of, so how this pump really looked like, which will be of great use and advantage of draining mines, serving towns with water and so forth. I would like to say that this spelling is correct. I mean, so this is the official spelling, right? It's not just how I type on my laptop, but still, this is just the example of the English of that time. And Thomas Savery actually gave the basis of the whole inventional, the queue of inventions of that period of time. So in the very beginning of the 18th century, we find also an interesting figure of inventor Thomas Newcomen, who improved Savery's pump, which used to break frequently. And he made it more safe in terms of working on the mill. Next, in 1733, someone, John Key, invented free shuttle to enhance the quantity of fabric which a weaver could produce per day. And it's interesting to underline that the phenomenon of Industrial Revolution is closely connected with the weavers, with the weavers, right, and the process of making fabric. Not also civil engineering, but different manufacturers that improved the way they made this or that fabric, because England, you remember, is famous for producing fabric, right? The next person whom we also have to mention is famous constructor James Watt, who invented the first steam engine. Mr. Savery, well, Captain Thomas Savery, used the pump, and James Watt decided to use also the cylinder, which helped to improve the very construction. Because he noticed that the construction of such a pump, for example, such a machine, really heats very fast, and we find it frequently goes out of order because it repeatedly reheats, right? And we have to it heats too much, and we have to reheat it repeatedly. So he decided to make it more or less mechanical. And here we can see also the construction of his engine and the very cylinder, which is here, right? So this is how he tried to improve this thing of so this engine to use it in factories. So the next one who we have to mention, also sorry for some Russian, of course I will improve it, but still we are speaking about the creators of the Industrial Revolution. This is Sir Richard Arkwright, who is not also famous as the inventor, but also a leading entrepreneur during the early industrial, the early period of Industrial Revolution. So Sir Arkwright is famous for inventing the first spinning frame, and he was actually the person who patented it. And he organized a large mill, a great factory, which was opened in Cromford, so this is the city in the north of England. And since 1790, he reconstructed his frames to supply them with steam engines. So he was not only the inventor, like the person who created something and he tries to repeat it day by day, but he also tried to improve the very industry. That is why he got actually the Sir title, right? And he also is famous for taking part, so for participating in some interesting processes, I mean judicial processes. So many people thought that he stole their ideas, and he was very free with patents. So there was even the joke that Sir Richard Arkwright got his title because he was a great robber, not a great inventor, right? But still, he popularized the very idea of creating these manufacturers, and the end of the result of his activity was the increase of the textile production effectiveness. The next person whom we also have to remember, especially in respect to Sir Richard Arkwright, is Samuel Crompton, who was the inventor and pioneer of spinning industry. So in 1764, we know that some James Hargreaves created so-called spinning jenny. So this was the machine that helped to improve the manufacturing process of creating textile by one man. Concerning Samuel Crompton, he actually improved this idea. So building on the work of James Hargreaves and Richard Arkwright, he invented this spinning mule. So what does mule mean in this respect? Spinning jenny was the construction that helped one person produce as much textile as possible, as much fabric as possible. Mule, you know, this is something in between the horse and the donkey, right? So this is a kind of the hybrid. The same thing was, the same idea had Samuel Crompton had. So he wanted to make one person to improve the industrial activity. And he tried to connect many engines, many machines in one, like in one machine, right? So it became possible for one person to create as much fabric, as much textile, as probably 10 people could work out per a day, right? So it became possible to improve the very industrial construction of the mills and the factories, and that is why Samuel Crompton was also very influential. So he revolutionized the very industry worldwide. But he was very lack of ambitions, let me say, and Sir Arkwright used his ideas very freely. That is why probably we know him as a Sir, not Mr. Crompton. The next person, which was actually also very influential in this time, was the one who created the locomotive, the train, as we know it nowadays. His name was George Stephenson, and he was the English civil engineer and mechanical engineer. So he first He built the first public intercity railway, and his very creation was a famous rocket. Hope you remember that this rocket was the kind of also a hybrid of the steam machine and the carriage, right? But still, he was probably the first successful inventor of this. We could also find different examples of Nicolas Cagnot, who actually is considered to be the pioneer of the automobile industry. But Mr. Stephenson decided to also to create a certain gauge, the rail gauge, that helped the steam locomotive to go further and go faster. That is why it is very important to mention him in this aspect. So he really gave the first standard of rail gauge, so of 4 feet and 8.5 inches, sometimes called, which is sometimes called the Stephenson gauge. And this is actually the conventional railway, right? Of course, you know that in different countries we have different railways railway gauge, but still, this was probably one of the first conventions in this aspect. He also was very active in his business. I mean, in his business of creating these steam locomotives, and he also opened the first railway from Liverpool to Manchester, which also called LMR, so Liverpool to, and Manchester Railway, and it happened in this 15th September of 1830. So between the Lancashire towns of Liverpool once again and Manchester in the UK. Of course, that was the great advantage of that period of time. Well, just to compare, we can say that it was as it was so influential that in France and in Germany they become buying. They started to buy this. The blueprints, right, of this railway and the very machine of Mr. Stephenson, and it started, the very industry started to develop very fast, very rapidly. But, for example, in the Russian Empire, it was only a kind of the piece of amusement, right? It was just a recreation, and probably until the Crimea War, so-called the Crimea War, of the second half of the, the middle of the 19th century and even the second half of the 19th century, in Russia we didn't have the professional industrial railways, right? So here we can see an interesting painting by a famous artist of the Great Britain, William Turner, which is called Steam, Rain and Velocity, as far as I remember, and speed probably, right? So here we can see actually the locomotive which runs on a certain railway above the bridge, right? And we can even say that this is not only the romanticism in colors, right? But also the very ambitious project that we can move faster, and that is why we can communicate with different parts of a certain city or different parts of certain country or even the continent very fast, right? Another person who also very was very influential in terms of this communication and the development of relations between different countries and the idea of speed, that, right, which was very popular in this period of time, was Mr. Isambard Kingdom Brunel, also an outstanding engineer and shipbuilder of the 18th century. So he was the son of also a famous engineer, Brunel, Samuel Brunel, who came to England from France during the French Revolution. So Brunel is famous for his great and very ambitious project concerning creating great ships, like Great Eastern, for example. He also developed SS, so double S, Great Britain, so the first propeller-driven ocean-going iron ship. And he was the person who really made the first plan and the first project of the Panamanian Channel 50 years before it came to life, right? So Isambard Brunel actually is considered to be one of the most important Britons ever, one of the greatest Britons ever. You know that this kind of project, the greatest representatives of these of that nation took place in the very beginning of the 21st century. So in Great Britain, the survey called 100 Great Britons, and number one was taken by Sir Winston Churchill, and we could probably agree with that. So second place was for Mr. Brunel, right? Number eight was John Lennon, as far as I remember, and number four was Princess Diana, right? And also here we can see an interesting picture. This is a famous project of Mr. Brunel. So this is the hung bridge with no actually pillars, right? Only two pillars here, but nothing in between. And it is still works. It still works, right? It is still in the same place near the city of Bristol, where actually Isambard Brunel actively worked. So certainly the Industrial Revolution and the very rapid development of industries and engineering projects could not help provoking the different against phenomena, right? Different even riots against the machines. And in the very beginning of the 19th century, we find this kind of riots in Nottingham, where an interesting movement of the Luddites, which also was named after a famous folk character, Ned Ludd, who is considered probably to be the first person who smashed the stock and frame in the very end of the 18th century. So a lot of people started losing their work, losing their places at the factories, because more and more machines appeared in that places and people needed no more. So they smashed these stock and frames. And it's interesting that in the beginning of the 19th century, the Parliament of Great Britain decided to discuss the possibility of death penalty for those who smashed the stock and frames, because that was private property of the businessmen and the entrepreneurs and those who actually run the business on factories and mills. And one of the probably the most famous reactions against that was the one of Lord Byron, a famous romanticist and famous poet, who wrote his powerful ode to the framers of the frame bill, and also the song for the Luddites, right? His speech in the Parliament was dedicated to this issue, so he tried to protect the Luddites, saying that when he's traveled in Turkey, and well, actually Greece and Albania, so that was under Turkey that time, and they were not Christians, so that was really the argument. So he said that even in the non-Christian lands, I couldn't see such barbarian attitude to their people, right, to their subjects, as we find in Christianized Europe. Actually, the speech failed, but this is a very interesting example of how Lord Byron tried to show his interest in different social challenges of his time. So, also I have to mention that Luddites was not only the phenomenon of the beginning of 19th century, but also in the 20th century and the very beginning of the 21st century, you find so-called neo-Luddites. So people who try to protect the interests against so-called the rights of machines, right? So We will discuss it next time, so next lecture, but we can't say that this phenomenon is only a historical one. So in the very present time, we also face with it. The Great French Revolution, which occurred in the very end of the 18th century and started in on the 14th of July 1789 with storming of the Bastille, also provoked very interesting questions and challenges, so we can say nowadays from the historical perspective. And among the most important achievements of the French Revolution, we should mention that it finished with the so-called the coup of the 18th Brumaire, but when Napoleon I came in force and the new French regime started, so the regime of so-called Napoleon Empire. But on the other hand, we find that that was the time when the middle class emerged as such. So we remember that the Industrial Revolution produced the question of judicial support, right? The law, the support of law, I mean the support of interest of the businessmen and entrepreneurs, so men of industry, as we could say. And in Germany, famous, well, this famous middle class in Germany was called the burghers, right? And the, in France, that was bourgeoisie, which also came in different languages all over the world. But the same, or more or less the same processes of rise of the middle class as such, provoked a quite interesting reaction in Great Britain when the Dandies appeared. So we would give the example of this middle class interest in from the perspective of dandyism now, and I think that is quite illustrious and even interesting in terms of how not noble men, untitled men, try to defend their interest in face of the nobility, which also was in force. So the dandyism actually was the phenomenon which started in the end of the 18th century. And so who were the dandies? Actually, we don't know the very etymology of dandy, so we can't say that what really this word means, but there is a hypothesis but that in Scotland, by dandy, they meant the turkey. Well, maybe just, it could be the lame example in English, but still it's very illustrious concerning Russian, the Russian language. So for example, we say that somebody is, I mean, the idea that somebody is, looks like a dandy, in Russian we usually say that he's a pigeon, right? So pigeon, right, this is the same word in French. So in these terms, dandy is also a kind of the metaphor, right? So somebody is Jack o' Dandy, said the Scots, when they saw that somebody wants to be very ambitious, right, in this or that actions, or somebody wants to show that he's very fitty or very showy, right? So probably this is just the common metaphor in the Indo-European languages. So dandies actually were the young untitled men who were perfectly well brought, and they educated, and also they had considerable money, which they didn't get by working with their hands. So usually they were the hires of the entrepreneurs and those who run their own businesses and so forth. So probably the most illustrious person in this respect was George Bryan Brummell, who is considered the icon of dandies. He got his education in Eton, the College of Eton, and among of his best friends was then, that time, Prince of Wales and further King of England, George IV. So, because they just started together in, at Eton. And George Brummell was usually the first person who appeared on the first place in the list of untitled guests in every society, right? In every high class company. So he really was influential because, so here you can see the picture of George Brummel. He created the man's suit, right? So he was the person who created the man's fashion. First of all, the jacket, then the trousers, right? And the very idea of tie, especially the cravat. The thing was that nobility in England was very, well, let me say, shabby, right? So they were not very careful about their view, about how they looked. There is even the joke of the end of the 19th century. So a famous philosopher, Bertrand Russell, of course, said that he's too well dressed for a gentleman, right? That meant that actually the gentleman is the one who doesn't care about how he looks like, right? Because he has title, he has this or that property, he is very interested with hunting, but not society. Well, he marries only in the same circle, right, and so forth. So dandies understood this fashion as the possibility, even the opportunity, to make the opposition to nobility. So they were aristocracy, let me say, by spirit, not by blood, right? So they looked like aristocrats of spirit because they were very well brought and very well educated, but they also looked very well. So one of the ideas of dandyism actually is so-called conspicuous inconspicuousness. So that really means that the one who is a dandy, so Lord Byron, for example, was very, well, really sympathized dandies, but he could never be a dandy because he was Lord, right? So he had title. So he said, well, the idea was that we, so the dandies must make the impression on other people, but, so that was really the impression that another person must really wanted to continue the conversation, and dandy escaped, right? So they don't, they always kept the famous English distance, right, to other people, which made really the impression of this exclusionism, as some authors say, right? So dandyism was a quite interesting reaction to this nobility, let me say, right, to the nobleman of the end of the 19th century. And it's also very interesting that this was the possibility for the middle class to rise and increase their power also in Parliament. Nowadays, we know that the House of Commons is probably the main part of the Parliament, right? And the House of Lords is so to say, ceremonial part, right? So in the 19th century, of course, now House of Commons was much more ceremonial than the House of Lords nowadays. And the middle class actually became the force which first tried to represent the ideas and the demands of the society of entrepreneurs and businessmen and those who worked for their own, right? Not got the title, not hide the title, right? As far as we are talking about dandyism and the 19th century, we cannot help speaking about the epoch of Romanticism. So we have already mentioned Lord Byron. And Romanticism was a quite interesting period of time. We could say that this was the period of theomachy. So theomachy is a complex word which is made of two Greek words, so theos, which actually means God. You remember that's theocentrism, right? And machi, so machia in Greek, that means war. So the idea of Romanticism, the very hard core of Romanticism, as we could say nowadays, was both in literature as well as in art in general, was the idea of the opposition of the creator, I mean the artist, to God. And that is why probably the most interesting subject, the most interesting character of literature and art of Romanticism is devil, Satan, as we say. So we must not think that this was understood in religious way. You remember that famous John Milton wrote his great poem Paradise Lost and that Paradise Regained. So Satan was understood as the one who made the first opposition to God, because he was very proud of himself. So romanticists really thought that they can recreate the whole world. You remember that we said last time that the idea of the scientist was that we have to study nature and we have to study the outer world, then we know, that means, as far as we study the world, that means that we know how it works, right? We do not need God as hypothesis because we have physics of Newton, first of all, right? Galileo and Newton. So here we can see the same ambition. As far as we are creators ourselves, as far as we are the artists, we want to recreate, renew the whole world, and God is the one whom we must make the opposition to, right? As far as Satan became the negative character, of course, right, became the object of interest of that time, we can also find a different tendency to recreate and renew the folk and popular culture. By folk and popular, I mean, first of all, the national culture of the Middle Ages. Of course, Europe was Christianized, and, well, this is no problem, right? Not a question. But still, this created the underground, let me say, culture of popular motifs and very folklore. So carnivals, for example, right, in Cologne or in Venice, in different other cities of Europe, were very popular. Mardi Gras, of course, right, and so forth. And these romanticists, for example, Victor Hugo or Percy Shelley, many other people, they really made Theodor Hoffmann, for Ernst Hoffmann in Germany, they made a great effort to bring interest to these folk motives. And we could just give just one example. So a famous cathedral of Notre Dame was really considered to be the ugliest building in Paris of the 19th century. And by 1830, when a famous novel by Victor Hugo was published, the government wanted to just blow it up, right, to destroy it. So Victor Hugo also got the interest, well, brought the interest back to this construction, to this building, and we know that the Cathedral of Notre Dame is actually one of the most interesting places and places of interest, right, in modern Paris. But as far as I have already mentioned that, the folklore and the idea of opposition to God, who also was considered to be rational, right? So God created the whole world rationally. So he gave laws to the whole nature and the whole universe, right? So the Romanticism created the idea of irrationalism. And these doctrines, for example, the one by Arthur Schopenhauer, or Friedrich Nietzsche, or Søren Kierkegaard, and many philosophers of the beginning of the 19th century, which came to force also in the 20th centuries. So when these irrational doctrines went hand by hand with nationalist idea, and we could even say, with no exaggeration, that one of the ultimate things that the period of Romanticism represents as such is the Nazi Germany, when the very idea of nationality and the pure blood came in force, right? We have to understand that because many people who actually worked in that time, in that period of time, I mean the 30s of the 20th century, thought that, well, did not think actually that this would lead to this kind of catastrophe which happens and as the World War II. But they thought that these are the national interests. And that was even the certain term of so-called Volkgeist or Deutsche Volk. Right, so the very nation of the Germans, right, which tried to gather together the whole nation, right. So this was a kind of objective circumstance of the 20th century, which takes place and, well, which actually appears in the very first half of the 19th century, and we cannot help mentioning that, right? But on the other hand, as I have already said, Romanticism came, well, was in force when an interesting movement of positivism took place. So on the very at the very first lecture, we mentioned that positivism is such a movement in philosophy which represents the third way of philosophy as such, besides materialism and idealism. So materialism, as far as you remember, is based upon the idea of experimental knowledge and matter. Idealism is based upon the idea of spirit and rationality, so we can understand how the world goes by our ration. Even if it is irrational, we can logically, we can logically describe this irrationality, right? But positivism is a kind of movement which really represents the third way. So it was among the premises, we can remember the industrial transformation of Europe, the corporations, the improvement of communication system, and so forth. This actually what was what the industrial revolution laid as the basis of positivism, with the very idea that the world could be connected with different nets, right, with different trade systems and the railway system and so forth. So positivism actually stands on the foundation of the Industrial Revolution. By the end of the 18th century, when deism came forth, and I hope that you remember that deism is the idea that if God created the whole universe, nowadays, so the present time, he doesn't intervene into the system, so we can work without any hypothesis of God, because we know the laws of nature and physics and so forth. So positivism really thought that scientific progress, the scientific development, will never stop, right? So this is perpetual. As far as it is perpetual, positivists said, we know more than, for example, the ancient Greeks knew, or the medieval people knew, or even Galileo and Newton knew. So we stand on this foundation, we stand on the shoulders of the giants, as always Newton said, right? But still, we improve our knowledge, we improve our ability of construction of different machines and engines and so forth. But at the same time, we believe that in future, the whole society, the whole science, and well, all the aspects of human activity would improve, and people will get the universal enlightenment. So one of the achievements of positivism, even if we do not accept it as a system, or we do not agree with the philosophical foundations, so one of the achievements is that it gave the motive, it got the it just coined in the idea of the universal enlightenment, right? So that was the period of time, and that was probably just the spirit of time which brought the idea, raised an idea of schools, universities, polytechnic schools, and so forth, right? So the places where people could get the education. So, speaking about positivism in terms of history of philosophy and history of science, we have to say that there are four main phases of positivism, which actually is 3+1. So phase one is classical positivism, and here are the representatives. Mr. Auguste Comte, who was the creator of positivism, the person who just coined in the term the positive philosophy. Positive, we have to remember, right? So that, what does it mean? Positive, that means that it is based on the empirical data, right? That is why it is positive, not because it is too optimistic. I would say that classical rationality was optimistic, but positivism was, realistic in these terms, right? So the second phase was so-called empirical criticism, and here are the representatives of empirical criticism. Ernst Mach, a famous philosopher and physicist, and also Richard Arvinarius. Yes, I didn't mention, so that was John Stuart Mill, who was also very influential, and Herbert Spencer, the one who supported Darwin's evolutionary theory. So here we can say that if in the in classical positivism they said that we have to put the ground, lay the basis of the empirical science for our meditation upon the very phenomenon of the object, right? So philosophy becomes theory of knowledge, epistemology. Then we understand that it must be the kind of objective knowledge, right? A kind of the positive science as such. So the best example of positive science really was sociology. Why? Because on the very very basis, the fundament of sciences, in terms of, and let me give, well, let me just bring this slide back, sorry. Beg your pardon. Yeah, concerning the idea of Auguste Comte, right? So what is the fundament, what is the basis of positivism? So this is mathematics. So everything could be understood in terms of mathematics, in terms of figures, and the mathematical operations. We can count everything, and actually mathematics is the most, as you remember, to Galileo said that this is the language of nature, right? So mathematics is actually the most general and less complex field of studies, which is the fundament upon which we find the second stage of astronomy. Astronomy is more specific, but less complex than physics, right? Physics is less specific because it speaks about the laws of nature, not only the ways that planets go by and so forth, but less complex than chemistry. So chemistry works with matter, with the elements, right? And this is much more specific than the laws of nature in general. But it is it is more specific, but less complex than biology, because all the biological stuff, right, the animals, the human beings, the plants, the mushrooms, so everything in the world, which we find in the biological world, everything works and, well, actually is connected, it consists of the elements, right? So ultimately, this is chemistry. But it is more specific because we are speaking about their own modus vivendi, if it is possible to say, right? So how the world of biology works, lives by its own. But it is less complex and more general comparing to sociology, because the human being is only one of the different parts of the whole biology, right? And we have to study it separately from all other biological organisms, because only men, right? Only people created society. But society is something very rational. And actually, we can measure the rationality of society, and we can give the laws of how it develops, right? That is why it is the most complex and the most specific disciplines is based upon mathematics, right? So what is the idea of sociology, which actually was the science which Mr. Comte produced? That is possibility of measuring society and giving laws of society, right? Also, Auguste Comte is also famous for his law of three stages, which not only the whole humanity passes, but each certain person passes. So the first is mythological part, right? We could say the theological part, when people really believes that the world is full of gods. The second stage is when they realize that they are not gods themselves, but the certain concepts, right? And we can think about how it really works, and we can try to understand the rational idea of this world. So this is the metaphysical phase, the metaphysical level of understanding of the universe. And the third law, sorry, the third stage that whole humanity passes is the positivist, or scientific period, the scientific level. And actually, Auguste Comte thought that the development of science and his own idea of sociology gives this kind of perspective, right? So after Auguste Comte, we are in positive, or on the positive stage, and we can learn more and more perpetually, right? Both about the world and the human society as such. So once again, here we can see empirical criticism. So the criticism, or actually the critique of our feelings, so how do we get information from the outer world? And well, this is quite a specific way of thinking, because once again, Ernst Mach was first of all the physicist, not the philosopher. The transition period from the second phase of positivism to the third one was the period, well, the school of conventionalism, let me say, and probably the most important and influential representative of this period, of this movement, was a famous mathematician from France, Henri Poincaré, who said that the concepts and terms that we use in science, well, actually in scientific discourse, they all are conventions. So we just say that 2 and 2 makes 4, that it doesn't mean that really there is something like 2 and there is something that like 4 in nature, but we think in this way. So this is how we make the convention, like the very language. So let us say that this is table. You say like, let us say that 2 and 2 makes 4, and then if it is okay, so it really helps us to improve, to develop our scientific discourse, we may go further, right? So if it works, we adopt the convention and go further and study the whole world, right? If it is rational. If it is not, we change the convention, or we will try to give the better one, right? So the third period of positivism, the third phase of positivism, is the logical positivism, so-called, and it is connected with the Vienna Circle. And here we can see the represent. Good, thank you. So the phase three, the logical positivism, is closely connected with the members of the Vienna Circle and analytic philosophy. So here are the pictures of the representative of the Vienna Circle. So people from Austria, right? Pre-war Austria. We're speaking about the First World War. So here is Moritz Schlick and Rudolf Carnap. So Schlick actually was killed, was murdered in at Vienna University in 1936. But Carnap immigrated from the Nazis to America, and there he continued. He carried on his investigations into mathematical logics, and he's a famous mathematician also, and logicist, right? And here we can see people who created so-called analytical traditions. So first of all, Lord Bertrand Russell, who is famous for his great book, I mean great in measure, right? Great by number of pages, which is called Principia Mathematica. So that is the attempt to reduce the whole the whole corpus of the whole body of mathematics to logics, to the laws of logics, right? Here we can see Mr. Ludwig Wittgenstein, who actually was born as an Austrian, but came to Cambridge, and well, he studied at Manchester University, and then he came to Cambridge and became a logicist, right, and the famous philosopher, one of the most influential, actually, philosophers of the 20th century. And here's Mr. George Moore, who also was one of the representatives of analytical philosophy. So the idea of this philosophy, of this trend, is that we have to analyze the way as we speak about this or that philosophical issue. So one of the theses of Wittgenstein was that if we clear our notions, if we clear our concepts that we use in the philosophical discourse, of course, many challenges of philosophy will go away, right? Will will be destroyed, because he thought that philosophers are those who create their problems because they do not use their language clearly. That is why we need the logical interpretation of our way of speech, right? So we have to understand these or that term very clearly, and as far as we do, we can give the objective knowledge, right? We can give the objective description, which is not dependent from the speakers, right? But it depends only on the objects we are discussing. Mr. Moore is also famous for his Principia Ethics, as Bertrand Russell tried to reduce the whole body of mathematics to the logical doctrine. Mr. Moore tried to reduce the whole multiplicity and difference of ethical ideas to the ideas of discussion. So we do not have to think about which action is good or bad. We have to think, what does it mean that we call it good, right? So the concept of good must be under consideration, not the action, which is good or bad, right? We do not have to say about, for example, that bravery is virtue, and cowardice, for example, is not a virtue, right? But we have to say that virtue is, and this is actually the dictionary, a kind of vocabulary of morals, not the discussion of these or that actions, as we have, as we find it, for example, in Aristotle's or Kant's discourse, right? And finally, I would also have to emphasize that phase number four is so-called post-positivism. So it took place in the second part of the 20th century. Here you can see the representatives, for example, Sir Karl Redmond Popper, and Imre Lakatos, and Thomas Kuhn, Paul Feyerabend, and Michael Polanyi. So these are those who criticized neo-positivism. Neo-positivism is another word for logical positivism, and of the third stage. And these are the thinkers that we will discuss next time, right? Because this is actually the issue of post-classical philosophy. So now we are going to discuss some two interesting, probably the most crucial doctrines of the 19th century in terms of the 20th century, because, as has have already said, Mr. Charles Darwin and Mr. Friedrich Nietzsche was those who made great impact in philosophy and science of the 20th century, not of the present situation. I mean, more on the science of the 20th century than their contemporary science. Of course, they had followers, and that's true. I mean, during their own lives, and for example, we could remember Aldous Huxley's grandfather, Thomas Huxley, who was called Darwin's bulldog, because he was actually the follower of Darwin and the one who popularized his doctrine. But still, we see that the evolutionary theory gave its fruit, of course, mainly in the first part of the 20th century, not in the end of the 19th, right? So the evolutionary doctrine of Charles Darwin starts its history since 1831, when Mr. Darwin went aboard Her Majesty's ship Beagle, which sailed to South America, and Darwin was the naturalist, the one who was going to depict the animals and run the journal, the board journal. It's also interesting to mention that we know the name of the captain of the ship. Also because Mr. Darwin. So Mr. Darwin, as you remember, he had turned up nose. And he was half bald even in his early age. So Mr. Fitzroy, Captain Fitzroy, really thought that a person who has turned up nose cannot be clever and cannot be reliable. So he rejected Darwin's personality, just as a candidate to run the journal of Beagle. But after some recommendations, he really took him, and probably this anecdote from Darwin's life gave the opportunity to Captain Fitzroy to stay in history, right? So Beagle's crew visited Brazil and Chile and Argentina, Peru, and the Galapagos Islands, where Darwin saw great lizards, right? Great representatives of the organisms of the previous age, which we could not find in, for example, Europe, right, or even in Asia. And when they returned 5 years later in 1836, Darwin really tried to realize his discoveries and the very material that he got from this voyage. And it took him 20 years to create his great magnum opus, which appeared in 1859 and called On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection. So this is the term which really Darwin coined in. So the natural selection is the mechanism, well, actually the engine of what we call evolutionary theory nowadays. Of course, the Darwin's evolutionary theory and the one that the investigators, well, even the historians of science discuss today, so this is not the same as, I'll say it another way. But mostly Darwin's doctrine is gives the interest to the historians of science. But still, this is the very first step of the further genetics, of further biology, and of course the elaboration of so-called synthetic evolutionary theory, right? And here is an interesting caricature to Charles Darwin. You remember that he was understood wrongly, so we'll never find the thesis that the person went from, hired from actually, right? So it appeared from the apes, but still this is a common phrase, right? And this is the caricature that Darwin as an ape, right? Darwin as monkey himself. Not the only, but there are a lot of caricatures like that, but still this is, he was really very upset with that, we can say. So what is the doctrine, right? So what is the idea of this evolutionary theory? So Darwin really thought, and I will try to use my mouse here. Darwin thought that organisms could be described in three aspects. So these aspects are heredity, variability, and unlimited reproduction capacity. So of course, many traits and many features that we deal with certain in this that organism are hired from parents, right, the parental organism. Of course, we can see a lot of different organisms in the world, so we can find that they are variable, right? Thirdly, we understand that only under certain circumstances, animals and plants, well, organisms in general, could be limited, could be restricted in their reproduction capacity if they're not healed, if they're not ill, right? So in these points of view, we can see that Darwin tries to give the objective description of the main features that we can find in organisms as such. But at the same time, we know that the conditions and the circumstances are limited. The distributions of sources is uneven. And certainly, we can see that this is the opposition. This brings the contradiction between the features of organisms and the objective circumstances of their living in nature. That is why the struggle for life is inevitable. So we face with this struggle for life. And the idea is that each organism really tries to stay alive, right? So the least fitted die, the most fitted survive. This is the idea, right? Darwin called this mechanism the engine of this evolutionary theory, natural selection, and it has three aspects as consequences. So the first is that organisms' fitness to environment shows that they are the most, well, actually the fittest, right, in this precise area, in this precise, well, field, let me say. Secondly, we can see that as far as we have struggle for life, and many organisms die, we cannot avoid the mixture, the confusion of different organisms, right? Even different species. That is why we have the variety of species. So different different species came in life. As we remember, we had spinning jenny, then spinning mule, right? So this is how the engine of production of mules work. And finally, the final aspect, number three, is gradual complication and increase of the organism, of organization level of the creatures. So the way the creatures organize their way of life and, let me say, society, right? The structure of this or that area also changes by this engine of natural selection. And now we see that, for example, evolution in Australia went in a completely different way than the evolution in Europe, for example, or evolution in Asia, because they thought that as a continent, Australia separated in the earliest period, right, probably the first, and evolution just changed the way. So we can see, for example, different animals that we can never find in other places, like echidna, for instance, right, or different other representatives. So this is only one track of development of this idea of evolutionary evolution as such, and this is very objective, this is very materialistic, let me say, because we are speaking about the field of biology, right, the field which works with objective organisms. The other one, the other powerful evolutionary even doctrine is related with the name of Friedrich Nietzsche, and he is famous as a prophet of so-called Übermensch, right, or the Superman, as we could say, or Overman, as they also give in different texts. So just some points concerning his biography. So here you can see the photo of Friedrich Nietzsche. He was born in 1846 and died in 1900. So he started as a classic scholar, and he was very famous in Prussia in his time, because he was adopted as the head of department of classical philology when he was 26. So he was on his last year at university. So he never defended the thesis, but he became the professor, and actually we could say doctor of science, right? When he was just a student, and well, this is just the illustrious phenomenon, right? The brilliant example of such a scholar, of such ability and of mind. But when he published his first book, his great first book, which he called Nietzschean Book, The Birth of Tragedy from the Spirit of Music, in 1872, he had to leave his university because the academic society rejected this book, and they said that this is not the publication of a scholar. This is the publication of the man of letters, not the classic investigator. Right, so many results of his book were not adopted by the academic society. However, nowadays we can say that this is the first book of Nietzsche as philosopher. And when he left university, he started his wandering life. And during 1870-80s, during 70s and 80s of the 19th century, he was working much and very fruitfully. So he really created numberless volumes and numberless works, so different papers and books and so forth, among which we could also remember his famous Also Spake Zarathustra, right? Where we see the prophecy of Superman and so-called, and some doctrines we will discuss a bit later, right? But we also have to mention that Friedrich Nietzsche was not influential among his contemporaries. So he became influential only after he got distraught and his mind eclipsed in 1889 in Turin. So last 10 years of his life he spent in a madhouse. But still, that was the period of time when his fame increased. And we know that during the 1890s, a lot of people drew the interest, drew the attention to this philosopher, because he was understood as a prophet. Among his among those who influenced on Nietzsche's ideas were Arthur Schopenhauer, Richard Wagner, and many representatives of so-called non-classical philosophy. But still, he is probably the first step to the so-called philosophical 20th century. We couldn't find really a person in the 20th century who wouldn't get back to Nietzsche's idea, quote him, and agree or completely disagree with him, right? So he is one of them, actually, the most influential authors ever. This is, we have to notice that, right? So what is the doctrine of Superman? So Friedrich Nietzsche said that we must coin in the idea of re-evaluation of values. So he really thought that the values that was created during our modernity, especially under strong influence of Christian doctrine and Catholic Church, must be revalued. So he even thought, but this is just an ultimate example which he tried to express in aphoristic way. He said that we have to hang up each Christian priest on the first tree, right? That was the idea that we have to revise the whole Christian doctrine because it doesn't teach us how to be strong anymore. Of course, it taught us how to be strong because when, for example, the Crusaders went to Palestine and tried to get the shrine of Lord from the Turks, right, from the Arabs, they were powerful because of their faith, because of the very Catholic idea, right? Because, they were actually the representatives of this Catholic point of view, the Christian point of view. But at the same time, Nietzsche says that by the 19th century, Christianity gives no more power, and this is, to believe anymore in the same doctrines means to degrade, right? To decrease the force of life, as he said that. So he even coined the idea of two kinds of morals, two kinds of morality. So there is morals of the slaves and morals of the masters. The slaves are those who are not in power anymore, who cannot create anything new, who are even, let us say, the very historical animals. So this is also a very interesting idea. Nietzsche said that animals could be distinguished from people in this aspect that animals do not have history, so they don't feel time, but people do. In this respect, there are different types of people, but the masters, in terms of this thesis of Nietzsche, the masters are those who look at history as only the material. They look at nations and people and different events only as the material to produce the phenomenon, right? To produce the event, to produce history as such. All the others, they live in history, so they are born, right? So they appear sometime and sometime die. That's why they are very temporal. But those who create history, they are not temporal, and they are very powerful in respect of understanding the situation, right? So they seize the day to create another, to create tomorrow. That is why we have different morals. So those who rule and those who subject the rules, who ordered the rules, right? Probably the most influential and most famous character of Nietzsche's meditation is Zarathustra. So he has nothing in common with the prophet from Iran of the very early period of the states, right? But still, Nietzsche tried to. So Nietzsche wanted to take him into consideration because he thought that Zarathustra was probably the first person who tried to create morality for a certain nation. That is why he must be the prophet of evaluation of values, right? As far as he is the first who created that, he must be the first who recreate that, who will bring another morality, the morality of powerful people. And this is also interesting in terms of his idea of eternal recurrence of the same. So Nietzsche said that history always recur, we always repeat the same faces, and actually the idea is not to repeat them, but to know that they are repeating. So try to understand ourselves not in terms of temporaneity, right, as temporal beasts, but as those who can rule time, who can rule this material, right, who could create history as such. Certainly, Nietzsche was very, how to say, Nietzsche is very famous nowadays in respect of the Nazi regime, but we must say that concerning his own notebooks and his journals, he really hated those who, for example, were anti-Semites and who said that Jews are not people and so forth. And this was the attitude to Jews, for example, to Hebrew people by the very end of the 19th century in different countries in Europe. So Nietzsche really didn't want us to confuse him with these kind of people. So when Hitler came in force, Nietzsche's sister Elizabeth made him visit the Nietzsche's archive, so-called Nietzsche's archive, and even to bow to the bust of Nietzsche, and that is why he really was considered to be the prophet of National Socialism. But still, we have to say that Elizabeth, so his sister, was the one who spoiled reputation of Nietzsche as a thinker, as an interesting philosopher for quite a long time. So nowadays we know, we have, the pure Nietzschean publication history, right? And we can know that, for example, Elizabeth really spoiled some books of her brother, because she tried to merge different parts of different anecdotes and citations and aphorisms into one book, which Nietzsche actually never wrote. Yeah. So we have to remember that on the one hand, Nietzsche was one of the most influential philosophers of the pre-20th century. On the other, probably one of the worst understood philosophers, and probably nowadays Nietzsche is not less, but even more topical than he used to be 50 years ago, let me say, right? So thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, you are welcome.